podcast number, episode number 6, and we have Jason Davis from Davis Customs here in Sanford, Florida with us. Thanks for joining us.
Absolutely, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thanks for the invite.
Yeah, yeah, it's good to have you. And before we get started, we're all going to have a little drink.
Cheers.
I got a fat tire
fat here. Fat tire's good.
What do you
high
got?
High lie.
High lie. There you go. Mm-hmm.
Happy Friday.
Start of the weekend.
Yep. Well, my weekend started this morning. So.
My workday still ain't over.
Yeah. We know.
You got to go back to work.
No. Not back to the shop, but it's still going on.
It never ends. Well, speaking of that, we're in the new location. Jason, this is the first time I think we've actually sat in air condition for an episode.
Yep.
So, lucky you,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, man. I watched y'all's first one. I think it was out in the shop.
Yeah. Steve, we sweated him out.
Yeah.
We're all over there.
Yeah.
But
Jason said, "I'm not coming until you have AC."
AC. It's got to be AC.
That works. Yeah, so, dude. I like AC. AC's good. AC is good.
So, Zip, we're in the new location, man. Tell us about it. How's it coming along?
It's coming along good. I mean, you know, it's pretty much all the work is done as far as build out and painting and stuff like that. You know, the inspections have been a lot of headaches, and you know, really, you know, I can't say it was you know, bad by the, you know, the inspectors are giving us a hard time, or it wasn't like that. You know, there's just little discrepancies. You know, it's the first time I did a commercial build out, a lot to learn. And you know, I
won't do it again, huh?
No, I'm you know, as soon as we move in here, I gotta start planning the next one.
Yeah,
honestly, you know, the building's the lease building, and you know, it's not the final end game, so you know, we'll move along as it goes.
And you feel it quick.
Oh, I know. Gets you can never make it big enough.
In. Yeah.
I remember when I moved in my shop, man, I walked in there, I was like, look at all this room. The day later, I'm shuffling through there. Like, yeah, well, that didn't work out too well.
Yeah.
But, yeah, they're never big enough.
No.
You could never build a shop big enough.
I'm excited to be neighbors, though.
I know, man. I can't wait.
I look literally over, right down the street.
Yeah, I sit at my desk, and I can see directly over there, and I'm like, oh,
what's in there?
I know what's all. I always know what's in, because you brought the roadster today.
Yeah.
And I hear it coming down the road there. And I'm like, yeah, man, it's pretty cool to have you right across the street. Yeah, we're going to have fun out here.
For real.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So when's the planning moving date?
Right now, so we just had a meeting about this yesterday, and so it looks like our final inspection is on Tuesday 29th, and so we're planning on starting on the 30th.
Okay.
You know, granted everything goes right, but so we're going. That's the Wednesday of not next week, week after, right?
Or yeah. Something like that.
Okay, yeah. So inspection is this Tuesday coming up, and then the following Wednesday we're going to start, because we have some low voltage network wiring and video surveillance and that kind of stuff to put in. So, you know, it was kind of a big originally wanted to just pack it into a Monday through Friday, and I think it was accomplishable, but tall order, you know, and, you know, we're shutting down the shop, everybody's on the clock, and we're going to gang up and do this thing.
But I
kind of felt like we should not make it such a diehard cutthroat thing, so we're going to start on a Wednesday, and basically with the plan of Wednesday through Friday, all the big stuff, you know, first we're going to move cars over, put them up on lifts, out of the way, cover them up, safety. And then we're going to get to moving toolboxes, kind of figure out everybody's place, where that goes. We might have some racks that need to move, you know, kind of get the vibe of, okay, this is our preliminary idea. And then we'll get into some of the equipment that's coming over here, parts. We got tons and tons of stuff, that parts and materials, supplies, stuff that's got to come over. So hoping that we get the majority of the stuff moved that needs to move over here. Then it's Labor Day weekend. Everybody take a 3-day weekend. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Get a real break in the middle of this rather than just killing yourself all week. And then we'll come back at it on Tuesday and break up in the teams. And we'll have, you know, several guys over here, you know, all administrative. And then guys in the shop inventorying stuff, putting stuff away, organizing, getting things set up. We'll be getting things set up in here, and then we'll have a crew at the body shop kind of cleaning that place out. We got two containers we've been renting for an obscene amount of time, and I mean, I could have probably bought 20 containers
for what you rented it for.
You know, and so we're putting an end to that. We're going to, you know, but when do you have time to unload a container and not have anywhere to put the stuff?
I know.
And, you know, and so now we will, you know, so we're going to put all that stuff in the shop. What needs to be, a lot of it's coming here. Some of it's getting tossed, and then having two bought containers dropped, and, you know, then kind of cleaning, painting, whatever over there, getting that prepped to be just a body shop.
Damn,
and hoping by that Friday, you know, we're ready to rock for the following Monday, you know. And then basically my, I guess, little carrot to hang out there is if we complete that on Friday, then I'm taking the whole crew out to dinner and families and everything, you know what I mean? And let's...
Shit, I'll help for
dinner. We did it. Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah.
Sign me up.
Yeah, I mean, bring it.
I like dinner. Dinner's good. Yeah.
So well, that's cool. We'll have a good little party.
It's going to be fun. I'm looking forward to you.
So for anybody that's listening that would want to come and, you know, see you about maybe getting some work done, do they go to the old location or do they come to the new location?
The new location. All this right. is going to be the main hub.
This will be the headquarters.
The old shop is just going to be body and paint for us. You know, it's not like an open to the public body and paint shop. You know, you can get just body and paint done, but through here and it gets done there. And so, you know, it's only 2 miles away.
See, that's what's going to work for you, is not having that Bondo dust on everything.
Yeah.
Right, right.
Because that drives me nuts.
Yeah.
I can't handle that.
Yeah.
I blow my shop out every day.
I believe
Before I leave, I crank up the blower and I blow it out because I don't like the dust.
We have too many processes happening in the same room.
Yeah, it's hard. We're
polishing this car, fabbing this car, you know.
You can't put a car together when you're sanding on it over here.
Right.
Well, good, man. I can't wait to, once this is all finalized and everything, that burden will be off your shoulders finally. Yeah.
So, you know, early September, we plan to be open and running. And, you know, we need a little bit of time to
get
our groove on and, you know, kind of be in the plus side. Because we've been running on the negative side a long time. And, you know, just due to space and accommodating this. And, you know, so once we kind of feel like things are moving, then we're going to get into planning our grand opening, you know, and have a big party here.
That's cool.
Big parties are good.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. That's looking forward to it.
Yeah, where Kirk and I were actually talking about podcasting during the party.
Yeah.
Like small ones, you know, so just various guests, you know, come in and talk and whatever.
Yep.
And, you know.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah, that'd be fun.
I'll be there.
All right.
That's because I'm in
you
the
don't have to, but two blocks ago.
I mean, that's his block party, right?
Yeah, so. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, I'll be here.
So, do you know the location, the address off the top of your head now?
Yeah, 1211 East 26th Place.
Oh, you got it.
San Florida.
You wrote enough checks.
32773.
Yeah, 32. Yeah. Oh, I'm Mellonville.
Yeah.
Yep, I'm on Mellonville.
Very cool.
And 26th Place is actually behind us.
That's what I thought.
You know, so everybody, like, maps will take you in. You could just pull right in, but everybody drives around.
They bring it around.
And then they finally find the entry, you know.
Yeah. That's cool. Well, Jason, again, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, man.
So
absolutely.
Your shop, like we mentioned, is literally, what, two blocks away from here?
I could throw a rock to it.
Yeah. So, and how long have you been at that shop there?
5 years.
5 years. And you specialize primarily, not primarily, but mostly in Volkswagen and Porsche.
Yeah.
For the most part.
Yeah.
What was the connection there? What got you involved into Volkswagens?
Well, grew up with Volkswagens in the 80s. Everybody had Volkswagens. My brother had a Bug. A buddy of mine, Don, wanted to, back in 03, wanted to get back into buses. So he buys his bus. He brings it to my house. And I was, at that time, I was doing, like, exterior customizing. I was, like, shaving door handles, you know, doing cool stuff on trucks. So brings me his bus, and he's like, I want you to put a roof on it. I'm like, no. It's like, look at this thing, dude. It's terrible. I don't even want it in my yard. He's like, just put the roof on for me. I said, all right. So I put an actual one of those 21-window roofs on
it. Yeah.
And it came out really nice. So I knew I had the knack for it.
Yeah.
But I really didn't know how good I was at it until I did that bus.
Okay.
And once the bus was done and painted and completed, you could never tell. And it won awards. I mean, the bus is beautiful.
Yeah.
So then a buddy of mine, as a matter of fact, he's a good buddy of mine. Him and I went to Coco today to pick up a 1961 Mercedes out of someone's backyard. But he brought me a bug. He wanted to chop it. Mm-hmm. I've never chopped a car in my life. I was like, yeah, I'll do it. Like, really? I was like, I'll do it. So I chopped it. The car had won like four best of chops.
No kidding.
So once I got into that car, it just really took off from there. And then once I got my foot into the Volkswagen family, everybody wanted me to start doing their stuff.
Yeah.
And what I'm super really anal about is door gaps, lines, and spot welds.
Okay.
So if it comes to me rotted out, when I'm done with it, I don't want it to look like somebody had fixed it.
Right.
I want the spot welds to look proper. I want it to look like Volkswagen had done that. So yeah, it was just bus after bus after bus. And actually in 2005 when it crashed,
mm-hmm,
I did 9 buses in a year.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, people were like, I'm not going to pay my mortgage. I'm going to build my bus.
I just got this check from the government.
Cool. Throw it towards a bus. I'm good with that. So it literally, that is really where it took off. And I was doing this out of my house. So on any given Saturday, there'd be 2 buses leaving and 3 pulling in on a trailer.
Oh, wow.
You know, and people were dropping them off. People were coming from North Carolina, Georgia, just bring them down just to do the metal work.
Wow.
So it started gradually getting bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
So I'm self-taught on everything that I do.
That's cool to know, man.
Sweet time.
about that chop, you know, like the, so that was kind of like the breaking point. And,
it was. That's cool, man. Cause, I knew that I love to paint. I don't like body work. I know how to do it. I don't want to do it. I hate it. I really do hate it. You put me in a booth, I'll walk in there and I'll paint a car. I'd love to do that. But like I said, I was self-taught. I taught myself to weld. I taught myself to paint because I couldn't afford anybody to do it for me.
Right, right.
You know? So basically what happened was I taught myself how to do Mondo work before I learned metal work. And that got to be a disaster because now it's getting thick and take me out of that. So I said, there's got to be an easier way to do this. So I started grafting metal and starting to figure out how I can get it smooth so I don't have to do so much body work. And that's where it really... it took off from that. And the Volkswagen world has taken off for me. So we sat down a couple weeks ago, and we figured out that the bus that I just had delivered is my 46th bus.
Wow.
So I've done 46 buses since probably 04, 05.
Wow.
Yeah. So I know them.
Yeah.
I can take them things apart in my sleep, you know. But I'm getting into the bay windows now. Like my parents' bay windows.
Yeah,
I'm getting into those now.
Yep.
Because they're the next big thing.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, just watching what they go for on
bring
a trailer or eBay or anything else, it's crazy how much. Like, even, what's the generation after that? The, the real Westphalia.
Those are Vanagans.
Yeah, even those are bringing money.
Huge
like,
money.
Dude, those were just $1,000 bus back in the day.
Well, they got the Synchros.
Yeah.
Those are your four-wheel drive Vanagans. Mm-hmm. Dude, they're $150,000.
It's crazy.
Right off the top.
I know.
And you're not touching it for no less than that.
I know.
It's insane. I mean, insane. Yeah, the Volkswagen world's good. I like it.
Yeah, like I had mentioned to you before, my parents bought a bus. And then after they bought it, I kind of got on the marketplace.
Yeah. Started
habit of looking at what these things are really worth and seeing if they got a deal or not, you know. Yeah. And all of a sudden it was like, holy crap.
They
like,
got it. They got
all right, you did all right, you know.
Is your parents, is it a Westie or is it a
top? No. And the person that had it before it did like a custom interior in it. So the interior is like an L shape.
Okay.
You know, so it has, yeah, I don't, it has the, what do you call it? The retractable.
Oh, it's got the rag top.
Yeah.
So somebody added that.
Probably. Yeah. I would think so. Did they not do that in the bay window?
Well, if you got a Westie,
mm-hmm,
you take that top off, you got a hole in the roof. So there's companies that make the sliders for those that fit down in there.
Yeah.
And you can have a canvas roof. John Sternberg's for us had that.
Yeah,
you could probably
that in
you
on
put
that.
It in, yeah, actually. Yeah. So
yeah.
So one of the few Volkswagens, really. We've done a couple, but usually if someone comes to me in the Volkswagen, go see Jason.
Yeah.
You know, it's a smarter idea.
That's actually how we met, was that bus.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And you know, the You are a bus expert, Volkswagen expert, you know. So somebody's money is going to be better spent with someone who specializes.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, like you want a chassis and LS platform thrown under your American muscle car. We got that, you know.
So have you ever done any Subaru swaps in a bus or bug or anything? No.
No, no.
Keep it all original.
Yeah, I'll turn them away.
Yeah.
Just because I don't like to take anything away from that. I'll tell you a funny story the other night. It's the first time that the wife and I were laying in bed. It's the first time I'd ever seen Tokyo Drift.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm not a Honda guy. Okay, I don't like seriously. You know,
sorry,
apologize. Anybody that's listening, but, you know, I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Probably not Honda guys.
Not a lot of Honda guys.
But I was watching the movie. I was like, all right, this is interesting. We're chilling out. And then, like, when they pulled out his dad's 68 Mustang and they started painting it, and then they went into scrap back there and they found the motor and they're going to put this freaking motor in there.
Yeah.
I just reached over and grabbed the motor.
I'm done.
And Holly's like, what are you doing? I was like, there's no way in hell I'm watching that, because that's wrong. You just don't do that. And you don't do it to an American car.
Yeah.
So it's okay to take a Ford or a Chevrolet and swap motors. That's fine. Don't put some, you know, Honda motor or something. Don't do that. It's not in the States. We don't do that.
Yeah.
So it's the same thing with Volkswagens. I think Volkswagens should be left Volkswagens. Yeah. You know, a lot of your rail buggy guys are putting LSs in them now, which is cool. I love it. That's awesome. But when it comes to the buses, no, I'm not cutting
you ever on YouTube, the Shreddy Life. Are you familiar with that? Blake Wilkie.
Okay.
Yeah, check that out. That guy, his shop's out in California, so he's, you know, it's the whole,
he's doing off-road
sand rail.
Yeah.
But he's big into the bugs, and he runs in Baja. He does the race with the original bug with all the EMP suspension and all that shit.
I love that.
But he got arrested for a YouTube video that he posted because he had an LS powered bug, you know, and he,
I know the bug.
Yep, he ran it up on the like on an embankment where there was a non-ramp, and he got arrested for that. So yeah, he just launched this week another one of his videos, and they were down in Mexico.
That's who that is,
dude. That car,
I just caught
that car is insane.
Yeah,
you know, sick, dude. You got your little thumbnails on YouTube, and so I see this monster bug jumping over a car.
Yeah.
That's it.
And Lane was there, and I'm like, oh, let's watch this. And you know, it was like kind of a Hoonigan vibe, you know, just thrash video with a car. It was cool.
Yeah, the car's insane. It'll come by you on three wheels. I mean, it's just like, and it just twists, you know, it's an A-arm car. Yeah, those are cool. I'm totally into that.
Yeah.
You know, but the buses, leave the buses alone.
So, okay, so the buses is where you kind of cut your teeth in, more or less. Did you jump in the bugs then too? That, I mean, seems like a kind of natural.
I was mixing.
Yeah.
I do pretty much all bugs and buses on the Volkswagen side now. I built my brother a 65 Mustang. So, it's got the Coyote motor in it, 5-speed.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's 4-link. I got rid of the front end and put Mustang 2 front end under it.
That's cool.
I still do my muscle car air. It's just the Volkswagens are my bread and butter.
Yeah.
You know, and I enjoy them. I just know them so much. So it's nice when I get, like, my brother's car in there working on my Nova. It gets me off the Volkswagens and gets me something else.
So you said what introduced you was swapping a roof and doing a
chop top.
Yeah, and then doing the chop top. But prior to that, you had to have got some experience doing metal work prior to that. How did that lead into that?
So basically, I'll just give you a quick rundown. We were talking about, I lived in Seattle. I lived in a vintage junkyard for 3 years. So everything was old, crusty, loved it. I thought I'd died and gone to heaven. I was just going for the summer, but I ended up living up there for 3 years. So that was, my mom says, that was more like my college. You know, that started me in the cars. I learned interchange. I learned all that stuff. Moved back to Florida, got a job at Napa.
Okay.
So I started learning parts behind the counters. I left Napa and I went and worked in a lube shop. So I learned tune-ups and I learned brakes and all that. Well, I left there and then I went into a tire store.
Yeah.
So I learned tires, bolt patterns, different sizes and all that, and heavy mechanics. So when I left there, I actually went into machine shop and worked in machine shop for a few years.
Okay.
And learned how to build motors.
Yeah.
So I was building motors. And then I needed to learn how to weld. So I went and bought a cheap welder. On the way home, I actually found a bed frame laying in the road. So I stopped and got it, built the welder frame. And my welder sat on that frame for 10 years.
That's cool.
And that's how I learned to weld, literally. And I was self-taught. And then I would just sit there and weld if I burn a hole in the quarter panel or something. I'm like, okay, it's too hot, so let's change it.
You know? Now, who was it that you moved up to Seattle?
That was was my stepdad's like best friend kind of brother. They grew up together. We called him Scrap Iron.
So you could honestly say he was kind of your mentor. He was into the automotive world then.
Scrap Iron Charlie is—he literally is the mentor and the reason I am where I am today.
That's cool. Yeah.
And his son is Paris Shepherd. So Paris now lives here, but Paris was one of the first guitarists for Nirvana.
No shit.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Yeah. Damn. And he lives here.
All right. No kidding.
So Paris Shepherd.
This is
yep.
the rest of the episode.
Yeah. All right. So, but that's where I got started at. And he always told me, he said, listen, if you want to, you know, I was dropping out of school. When I turned 18, I went and turned my books and they're like, you're quitting. I'm like, yeah, I'm in a scrap yard up the street. I made $1,200 last week.
Yeah.
And I haven't made a dime here.
Yeah.
So I'm going there. I'm going to do that. But he told me, he says, you know, if you made up your mind to drop out, he says, you need to do something that's going to fill your life for the rest of your life. Because that's just, you know, what do you do?
Mm-hmm.
And he did the same thing. He opened up a wrecking yard. So he was there from day one.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, he was absolutely. And then when I got into the machine shop, Ron Smith was the owner of the machine shop. He took me under his wing, and he was my, like, second.
Okay.
Monitor. So I've had three. John Sellers, which owned Tire City, I call him my adopted dad.
Mm-hmm.
We're very close. But he taught me wheels, tires. He taught me business. He taught me a lot. And those mentors that you have will collide now. You know, I'm 52 years old, so I've paid the dues. So now it's...
You are?
Now,
yeah.
Yeah. So now we play. So, and I enjoy it.
That's cool.
I enjoy it. I love it, man. I'm in the highlight of my life right now.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So when you were in Seattle, how old were you then?
I was 16 when I left.
16. So you went up there, dove into your learning, you know, the automotive side of things, and what drove you up there was a Nova.
A Nova.
Right? He said, you come up here.
Build a Nova.
Build a Nova, and you can drive it back home.
Because I wasn't exactly in good terms here. I was always in trouble. I was always at someone's shop. I would skip school and go hang out in the body shop.
Yeah.
I had no desire to be in school. My mom will tell you to this day I was born with a Hot Wheels in my hand. And I was. Cars, I am. If you come to my house, we watch car shows.
Yeah.
You know, my kids are now, they're like, Dodge.
Yeah.
Oh, there goes a Ford, you know.
Yeah.
And Nova 6 and Shelby's 4, you know. So
that's cool.
My kids know cars. Because that's who we are. Yeah, that's just who we are. So, I mean, if you ever really wanted a true definition of a motorhead, I'm probably 100% motorhead.
Yeah.
I mean, oil runs through my blood.
Yeah.
And anybody that knows me, we're like, yeah, he's ate up with cars.
Yeah.
And I have been my whole life, you know. But, yeah, that's how. So that just moved me on, and it kept me going.
So you got up there, got to mess with the Nova. That was a 65?
Nope, that was a 62 Nova.
Okay.
I built the car, V8, everything. Mm-hmm. I had to build it to travel.
Yeah.
So he's like, you know, we're not putting performance parts in this.
Right,
we're going to drive this cross country. It's, you know, no, you're not getting fancy wheels. You're not getting 9-inch rear end. You're getting a stock S10 rear end and disc brakes. That's it.
Yeah.
You know? So I'm like, all right. And a 2-barrel motor.
Yeah, but when you came back home...
Yeah,
well, the Nova.
The car, made it home,
I never,
right?
Yeah. No, I never made it. I couldn't make it with the car.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yes. So what happened was, is my grandfather was very ill at that time. I came down for Christmas. I came home every Christmas. And my mom's the one that sent me there, and then she's the one that talked me into staying.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, yeah, I probably need to stay. So I kind of settled, and I called Scrap Iron, and he was disappointed. And he said, well, we'll try to get the car for you. Well, back in the 80s, you know, to get a car shipped down here was ridiculous. And back then they had impact fees. And the impact fee would have been $3,000-$4,000 to even get it registered
more than
in the
value
state
of
Florida.
The car
Scrap Iron's like, dude, just, you know, find a Nova down there. I was like, all right. So I was heartbroken for a little bit until I found Scratch.
Yeah.
And I found Scratch just by accident. You know, I was driving down one of the back roads by your shop and it was sitting there. And I was like, oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was you were sharing that earlier. So you had a Celica.
I was driving. Yes, I'm a Celica guy too. I love early Celicas.
Yeah.
So at that time, I had an 80 Celica GT that I bought from my dad. my roommate wanted a car bad, and I was like, no, I'm a V8 it. No, you ain't getting it. You
yeah. know?
This was pre-scratch. So when I saw scratch, I called my mom. Nope, not giving you a dime. Call my dad. No, son, you're crazy. You know, I just gave you myself. No, you're not getting nothing. So I wrote out to Bob's work. I said, Bob, you want my Celica? He's like, yeah. I was like, you give me $500 and a ride back Sanford's yours. And he's like, really? I'm like, yeah, I mean, now. I'm not, this ain't negotiable.
Yeah, because the leaving. Guy that had the Nova was leaving.
He was leaving to go out of town.
And he wanted it sold that yeah, day.
He wanted it gone, and I wanted the car. So we loaded up, and he checked out and loaded up on the in the Celica. We drove back to Sanford. I got the car, drove it home.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That is cool.
And I've had it now. It's 34 years.
Wow. 34 years.
Yeah, I bought it for my birthday.
Yeah.
1989.
So was it just a stock car at the time?
God, it was a grandpa kicker, man.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a six banger. It was automatic. It had the big wheel. It had the 13-inch five lugs on it.
Yeah. Nice.
The first thing it went was the steering wheel. I had to get the little steering wheel. Then I had to put a floor shifter in it because that was just, you know, thing you did. Then you put wheels on it.
Yeah.
Kind of muscle it out. Leave the motor for last.
Yeah.
I can't afford a motor.
That's the expensive part.
That's the expensive part. But you can look fast. There ain't nothing wrong with that, you know.
So. How long did it take? Because pretty much every Nova eventually turns into a street car. How long was it before it was a street car?
It was probably, I drove that car for probably 2 years.
Yeah.
With a six-cylinder in it. But I had rally wheels on it, you know. It was fixed up, but we kept the six-cylinder. Damn thing runs so good. I mean, you couldn't beat it. But I ended up building a 350 for it and then put that in there, and that was it. It's V8'd ever since then.
Yeah.
So.
What does it have now?
Now it's got a, it's got 350 in it.
No, it's still small block Chevy.
Yep. Small block Chevy. It's got a 53 millimeter turbo.
Okay.
So I've done the car like six times. So I'm over it. I'm getting older now. I'm tired of the car being apart. It's time to get the car done. So this is going to be the very last time I do it. I've never, this time it's going to be the way I've always wanted the car. So I went to the firewall and cut every bit of the car out.
Oh, no kidding.
And rebuilt everything. So the thing about Scratch is he's never been in another shop. There's no one's ever touched that car.
Yeah.
I've painted it every time. I've done the interior every time. I've done all the weld work.
Every corner.
The car's never been touched.
Yep.
And the painter that I use now, he's like, I'm painting him. I'm like, no, you're not.
Yeah.
You can paint any car you want, but you're not touching that car.
Yeah.
And I had actually considered it. And my wife was like, no, there's no way you're painting that car. You don't let nobody touch Scratch and you're painting. So this time it's all tube chassis. Yeah, I just did, all the floors are all handmade. The tubs are made. The trunk's all handmade.
Yeah.
You know, the trunk used to come down all the way to the bumper. I cut it, put a fiberglass lid on it, but I molded the taillight section in. So that's all molded into the car.
Oh, so it's like a Corvair.
Yeah, it's got it. Yeah, right. It's got a hatch on it.
That's cool.
So what I'm doing with the car is I'm keeping it all original. So basically, like if they sold a white 1965 Nova Pro Street car, that would be it. You know, all my lights are going to work. My heat works.
Yep.
The dome lights.
Yep.
Everything's going to be functional in the car. It's just going to be like, how could you possibly drive that on the street?
Kind of thing, you know? I like it.
And that's what I'm ready for.
Yeah.
But yeah, I didn't buy the Mustang 2 front end. I built it.
Uh-huh.
You know, I go online and I'm like, I look at this stuff online. I'm like, dude, I'm not paying $700 for a $30 piece of steel that I can build myself.
Yeah.
And I'll do it my design and even better.
Right.
So I got it where it's tucked up. It's not down low. And I kept my frame rails. So, you know, the old Nose had them shock towers. Mm-hmm. Well, I skinned them. And once you skin those, you get down to the factory frame rails. It's the same thing they sell in the magazine.
Yeah.
It just don't have the shock towers on there. So now my radiator core's still proper. My fenders bolt up properly. I don't have no alignment issues.
You get all that space.
And it's a Mustang 2 front end. So.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah. And that's what I like about it. I like the whole build yourself build, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, it's easy to buy the parts. I'm enjoying buying the parts, but a lot of stuff I like to build.
Yeah. It's cool that that generation of 60s muscle cars. So on the right here, I was listening to Joe Rogan's podcast. He just had the guys from Roadster Shop on his podcast.
Oh, yeah.
Because they just finished the Cuda.
Was on their Oil and Whiskey recently, too.
Mm-hmm. So he was on the guy, the three of them flew into Austin and was on the show because they delivered that 70 Cuda that he's got, or 70. Yeah,
Sickfish.
Yeah, Sickfish. Yeah.
Yep.
So Rogan had a theory. Everything from the 60s was the designers. There was just a hell of a lot of good drugs.
Yeah, they were.
Because they were all on acid.
Yeah.
Because if you really think about it, like he made the point in the 50s, like all the cars were very kind of executive, mm-hmm. very proper, very, you know, good straight lines. Everything had like a foot.
Yeah.
And then enter the 60s and the early 70s, and it was just
muscle car. Hell muscle yeah. Car, man. Faster you go, the better you want. Yep. You know, yeah. Your 40s and 50s cars were actually designed. After World War II, GM and Ford and Dodge, they wanted you to buy cars to travel. Mm-hmm. They wanted you to go on highways. Cause highways
that was when they were doing the interstates.
And they wanted, yep. to, so they yep. built those cars to actually travel. You know, that's why they had the big fluffy seats and yep. they were so comfortable to ride in.
There was, I remember seeing, I think it was a printed ad where the glove box opened up and there was a Scotch set.
Oh yeah,
you know?
Yeah, man. Yeah.
So your before, wife could literally make you road dogs while you're traveling.
Yep, yep. Advertising, not driving, drinking and driving. Yeah. It's great.
You know, that was the 50s.
It was. Yeah, yeah.
60s.
Bless their hearts.
Was a little bit more of the drug route, but
yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, no, it was just kind of funny hearing his theory on that. And then you kind of think about it, you're like, yeah, I mean, that era of car, pretty much after 72, it starts to wean off. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And then you get in the 80s and you had all the bumpers that you had to have, you know.
Yeah, that shoot, else. That was 74, 75 when they come with the push bumpers.
Yep, you had to have
the gas crunch is what really killed the muscle car back then.
Yep.
The 60s was actually the birth of muscle cars.
Yeah. And absolutely.
They ran with it for years, you know. Dodge held it for a long time, yep. you know. But they all had fast cars. Mm-hmm. Ford came out fast cars. Chevy did. They all did.
Yeah.
So I just hope they'll come back. You know, they're starting to come back slowly mm-hmm. now.
I mean, there's some fast cars you can buy at
the dealership. You can get 1,000 horsepower.
Yeah.
You know, Challenger yeah. and Charger. It's yeah. like, what the hell?
It's insane.
I know. The Shelbys, everything.
It's awesome. I think it's great. I mean, the more the merrier, man.
It almost feels like they're throwing everything at it right now because they're fearful of what this electric car thing's going to do sometimes.
Yeah, it's not going nowhere.
And that's the thing. Yeah. Like, it's not, I don't see how it could transition because you can't flip the switch and make everybody drive an electric car.
Yeah.
The cost of it's just too, it's going to be a transition over 20 years, probably.
You can't charge everybody's electric car if everybody's driving an electric car. Mm-hmm. But it's double the amount of electric consumption we have now.
Yeah.
And to make that happen. But right now, it's making a bunch of people money by thinking that way and making laws that are saying it's going that way. Mm-hmm. And really they don't care how that actually works.
And I think it's worse. You're making the power plants work 10 times harder.
Yep. How can that possibly?
If they've done anything well, they've seemed to control more smog with cars now than they have in the past days, and I think that's probably helped. It's not going to cure the problem because you'll never cure that problem. You know, especially me, I'm not giving up that. It's not an
app. Right.
You know, mine Lincoln still has smog on it. Still works. You know, I figured when the computers finally crash and all the cars just stop in the middle of the road, I'm going to buzz right by my Lincoln, man.
Like deuces.
Yep, I'm keeping my 2-barrel. You know, I don't care if it gets 7 miles a gallon downhill. Don't bother me. Right. I only drive to Deltona.
Right.
You know.
Well, the one, gosh, his name escapes me right now, but I interviewed him at SEMA. Mike is his first name, and I can't think of his last name right now. But he was the engineer for GM years ago, and then he went to Mopar when they were doing
Mike Kaluka or no, mm-mm. What's his name?
It'll come to me.
I know who you're talking
about. But he's spent, invested a lot of his time and money into doing the hydrogen conversion. So the first one that he had was a 53 Chevy pickup that he did a hydrogen conversion, and he worked with Bosch in doing that, and it just had an LS in it.
Mm-hmm.
But he knew that vehicle, because he lost power in that, it went from whatever a 500 horsepower LS and dropped down into like 350, 400 range. He's like, I know I can't sell this, right? Nobody in the performance realm is going to go, I'll take it, but it kind of sucks because my car's slower, you know, it doesn't have as much horsepower. They finally figured out all the technology on that, and he had it was a Ford G Galaxy, I think, this year that they did a Coyote in it, mm-hmm. and it was running off hydrogen, and it actually gained horsepower. I think it was like 50 horsepower.
I think I saw some video on that.
But they finally ironed that out, okay. and now they're going to market with this technology. Yeah. And right now, of course, his biggest client is cities looking for their police yeah. force and yep. buses and, you know, county trucks and stuff yep. like that, because they can make their own hydrogen plant.
Absolutely.
They can fuel their own cars.
Yeah.
And they don't have to do anything with the motors that are already in the vehicles.
Exactly.
That vehicle can live the lifespan of whatever they use it for, 5 years or what have you, and just use their own fuel.
Well, Hyundai and Toyota have them in Australia in production.
Yeah. Well, a lot of your trucks, you know, your late 90s, early 2000s, big trucks, your 550s, they're propane.
I know.
You know?
Yep.
And I was in a machine shop at that time, and when you tear down a motor that's run off propane, dude, it's
super clean.
You don't have to tear. You don't have to even wash it. It's spotless.
The emission,
it's,
less emissions through it, less carbon.
And there's a lot of propane. It's pretty much everywhere.
I know.
You can get that. So it's we're not going to run out of fuels. I don't believe.
No.
I don't see that happening.
No.
Just leave me enough for my cars. You know, I want that smell. And I still want that.
Yeah.
I want to hear that motor. I want the rumble. I want the, you know, that's what it's about.
Yeah.
It's getting in a car with earphones on because it's too damn loud. That's what I want. I'm not into getting in a car and hearing rocks hit the fender wells because it's electric. You know, Amazon's got electric trucks now.
Yeah, I know.
I've seen them. They're funky looking.
I know.
I'm just waiting to see one of them burst up.
I think that was the, what's the company? The guy's from Sanford, actually.
Really?
The truck company that they do the electric trucks.
They
made the Amazon one.
Okay.
But yeah, that guy's actually from Sanford that started Rivian. Rivian.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what
he's
they're
from
called.
Sanford?
Yeah.
Wow.
No kidding.
Yep. Yeah.
Well, we probably need to get out a little bit more.
Yeah. Yeah. We're stuck in our shops all the time.
Yeah.
I don't know what's going on two doors down.
That's crazy, man.
All right. So you got a Nova. You also have, what do you call it? A bus?
It's a double cab.
Double cab.
Yeah,
okay.
That's a double cab. So my double cab, there is a company that I use called Classic Fab.
Mm-hmm.
He makes all the funky green panels. So if you follow me, you'll see all the panels I put on there green. So he owns Classic Fab, and he's also doing your Jap cars now. He's doing Datsuns and Toyotas.
Okay.
All those. So
from like 70s, 80s,
yeah,
or what?
Your 70s. Your 510s.
So like the 240s.
Yeah, he does all 240s.
Yeah.
So those cars are coming back. Celica's,
oh, God, yeah.
Holy crap. That's the next bus market. It really is.
Right.
His name's Gerson. I've been friends with him for years. I've done so many cars for him. And we just became really good friends. One day he shows up at my house.
Mm-hmm.
And I had no idea about it. I already had three of his cars there now. You know, and Gerson pulling up. I'm like, no, Gerson, there's three of your cars in the back. He's like, oh, wait a minute. Just give me a minute. He's like, you know, I talked to you. I talked to Bubba, and Bubba told me you wanted a double cab. He said, here you go. He said, you've done so much for me over the years. He's like, I'm giving you this double cab. He said, now make a list, because it was bad. It needed everything. He's like, make a list, call the shop, have everything delivered to you.
I'm
like,
no shit, awesome.
Really? He's like, yep, just do it.
Yeah.
So I built the bus. So I was like, well, if I'm going to do all that, I'm going to make it a double door.
Mm-hmm.
So a double door is, double cabs didn't come with a door on the driver's side.
Okay.
Behind you.
So it's just on the passenger side, like the old Suburbans did.
Yep.
Like the first gen Suburban.
Same thing.
Yep.
So I cut a door in there.
Okay.
I had him make the pillars for me, and because he makes every piece you need for a bus.
Yeah.
You can buy a whole complete bus from him if you want
to. So he's building the dies?
Yeah, he's got all the dies. He makes every piece for him. Same with Datsuns.
Yeah.
His quality is just spot on.
And he's here in the States, then?
He's here in the States, yeah. His factory is in South America, but he's based out of Jupiter.
Yeah.
Just incredible that he started that. You know, he traveled everywhere and found every NOS Volkswagen part he could find, and then he stamped off of that.
Yeah.
He's actually Volkswagen licensed now.
Yeah.
If they were ever to bring a bus back, they would probably use all his metal.
Yeah, I was going to ask you earlier when you were talking about doing metal repair.
Mm-hmm.
So when I worked at NPD, you know, we sold patch panels and full fenders and everything else. Most of the stuff we had came from Taiwan, but we would also have patch panels that came from Canada.
Mm-hmm.
And that quality of steel was always better than what we ever had at Taiwan.
Yeah, because you can't burn their metal. because Tamiya, there's so much crap in their metal. You try to spot it in, it just burns a bigger hole.
Yeah, the Taiwan metal. Yeah.
Terrible stuff. Absolutely terrible. If it's normally, if it's Taiwan, I won't even install it.
Really?
Yeah, I'll tell them to take this thing out here because it's, you know, I'm going to have more time in it trying to make this piece work. You could just call a better company and get a better product in here.
Yeah.
It saves on me, and because it doesn't leave my door until I'm satisfied with it. And even if it is a bad part, I have to make that bad part right because it's my name going out the door.
I mean, they when we worked with the guys in Taiwan, they were always really good with their stampings. But like you said, the quality of metal, I didn't realize that that it would burn through like
that. Oh, my gosh, yeah. Your metal's different.
Yeah.
Every metal, every manufacturer company that any metal, anything, the cheaper you buy, the cheaper the metal that they used. And a lot of their metal is just ground-up crap, you know. It's, there's no quality to it. Gerson's metal.
And they just use it maybe recycled metal and stuff. Yeah, absolutely. Is what it is.
Yeah. You know, and you get a lot of contaminants in there. Yeah. You get oils and you get, and it all gets mixed back into these molds and then they just repop them. And the stamping's never the same. You know, you can only stamp for so much and then it starts deforming. So you might get 150,000 dog legs for a bus out of one stamp.
Right.
And then you got to restamp it.
Yep.
Because it just, it deforms it.
Yeah, that's where...
the dyes wear out.
They wear out.
Yeah, Dennis Carpenter, you're familiar with their stuff.
Yep.
They were notorious on, I mean, dude, they got a field full of nothing but Ford stamps.
Yeah.
Because, you know, he specializes in Ford products and tractor stuff. Yes. You know, him and his brother both.
And he's Ford licensed.
Yep. But what they'll do is they'll take that Ford stamping and then make a new stamping based off of that had life in it.
Yeah. And that's just the way it works. Now, Gerson's metal, classic fab, you know, to sell legally, to sell an aftermarket part, it has to be 10% different. So Gerson.
Oh, really?
And that's why you'll get a panel that don't fit.
Because they have to make that modification.
It has to be different. So basically what he did was he actually kept the stamp exactly the same size. So from this seam to this seam is still right through Volkswagen, but he just thickened the metal. He went 10% thicker, which is better anyway.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't you?
Yep.
You
know, that makes sense.
Less block time.
Yep.
It just welds a lot better. Yep. I mean, I'll see the Volkswagen metal just start corroding away as Gerson's metal just flows right in there, you know.
Wow.
But that's the difference between the metal. I've learned a lot about metal since I've always been in it, you know.
And you said all his panels are green, so he's not he's not doing e-coating then.
No. This is just a coating so it doesn't rust shipping it to the States.
Right, so he can keep it on the shelf, but that way when you get it...
I take it off, or I leave it on there and just let them sandblast it.
We do the same with any e-coat.
The e-coating is just
the time it's freshly stamped to the time it gets coated.
It's already rusted.
It's rusted
through.
Nobody
knows. You know, I've taken e-coat off and the metal's perfect.
Yeah.
I take an e-coat off and it's fully surface rusted.
Yeah, and he stamps it. It leaves a stamp, and it goes over to his painter, and they spray it.
That's
and
cool.
And they dry it, and then it goes on the shelf. And he's known for the funky green panels.
So what is the name of this company again?
Classic Fab.
Classic Fab.
Classic Fab, yeah.
Yeah, anybody that's a Volkswagen connoisseur. They know him. And anybody that knows Japanese.
He's just started that within the last year, 2 years.
Yeah.
But it's really taken off because he's done the same with the Jap cars as he's done with the buses, you know.
Well, you know, LMC has their own line of, like, they do the 240s and everything. I think it's called Red Dragon.
Yeah, there's a couple companies out there doing it now.
Yeah.
And he's got a lot of competition now with the buses because for a while he was pretty much the first. You know, he's got a classic fab in Spain. He's all over the place. And there's a lot of companies out there now producing metal. You know, there's Classic Steel.
Yep.
Okay, they're doing Volkswagens now. So,
oh, really?
Yeah, I've used a couple of his products. It's funny. I have a bus in there with – he sent me some product down, and he called me. And he tells me, he says, yeah, I've been kind of waiting to – I saw your name come across the order sheet, and I was like, yeah, Dave's custom, you know, because I know he's a classic fab guy. So now my metal's going in the shop. And I told him, I said, I will let you know how it goes when I put it in my hands and put it on the bus because it's beautiful when it's in your hand. I mean, that beer can right there is absolutely gorgeous. It's beautiful. It's in your hand.
Right.
But until you put it into the refrigerator to see where it fits,
yep.
It's anybody's guess.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Same with metal, man. It's... I get some really crap. Did you see the Ford truck bed that I did? I did the corner of a Ford truck bed a couple
recently,
weeks.
Recently, yeah. I did see that.
That was by far the worst piece that I'd ever had delivered to my shop.
Yep.
Ever.
Yep.
It's like, wow, I can't even, you know, I had to reform the whole thing. Right. I could have probably just made it a new one.
I know.
And been done with it.
I know.
And I do a lot of hands-on work. The chopper that sits in my hallway, I built in 05.
Mm-hmm.
I watched that Discovery Channel when they did it on Jesse James.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. So I watched laying in bed and watched, I'm like, dude, I could do that. You know, so the next day, I actually built my English wheel to build that bike.
Cool. Oh, yeah.
And it's won 3 awards.
No kidding.
Yeah, I won Best Dometric in Daytona 105.
Uh-huh.
I did a show up in Myrtle Beach. So the bike's been around because it's a metric.
Okay.
It's an old Yamaha, but it's a 650 Yamaha, so it looks like a Triumph. It's mm-hmm. a standard.
Did you know the Colliers?
Hmm?
Did you know Colliers? Mm-mm. They were doing metrics around that time.
Yeah. I was fresh in it because I just wanted to get into bikes, and I only really built that bike because I saw Jesse James do it on TV.
Yeah.
Like, dude, that's the coolest thing I've ever seen. You know?
Yeah.
And that's really where I started shaping. I started, because when I made the English wheel, I went down to the scrapyard and bought bearings, huge bearings.
Mm-hmm.
And I found another bearing that was tapered on top, and I just got in a magazine and looked at the English wheel and said, well, okay, this is how it's going to go. And I made my fender extensions. And I was like, well, damn, that was easy. You know, now I use it all the time.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of times I'll make a piece and I have to make 5 before I get one.
Right.
Well, that's the learning curve.
And then there's some days and I'll go in there and whip it. And I'm like, damn.
Yeah.
You know, well, we need a beer for this one because this one's good, you know. So, but it's.
Do I have to do another one on the other side?
Yeah. When I do that. So I did, and you're getting ready to get the car. The BMW station wagon that I
got. Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, he's been talking to me about that rear window.
Yes. Yeah. So, Curtis owns WTF Motorsports in Orlando. He's a BMW guy.
Yeah. Okay.
Never met the guy. He sent me cars. I would fix them, ship them back. Never met him.
Mm-hmm.
One day, I'm down at Triangle Auto Parts, and I'm standing in there, and they come in there, and they're laughing at me. The guy's behind the counter. I was like, what's so funny? And he said, well, do you know Curtis? I'm like, never met the guy. Well, he's right here.
Cool.
So I got to meet him. So he says, I'm doing a project, and I wanna take it to the BMW convention in South Carolina. Will you build the car for me? I was like, sure. I was like, yeah. So he's like, I want to build a station wagon out of a 2000, and well, that was a 02, 2002 BMW.
Right.
Yeah, it was like a 70. Model.
Right.
Yeah, it was a 70.
Yep.
So sure, bring me another roof in the car.
Mm-hmm.
So he did. It's never been done before. There was one guy that had posted on the internet that tried to build one, but he's like, we couldn't do it, so we scrapped the car.
Yeah.
If you Google it, there was all of them were animated. So I was like, well, I'm going to do it. And he's like, you got to keep it hush. So I took another roof, stretched it. So the long window, the rear quarter windows, we stretched all the way to the back, and they still pop out. But the whole back of the car, I had to hand make.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah,
so
it came out good. It was at Amelia Island.
Yes.
Oh, no kidding.
It won the show. It won it. So he took it to the convention or the expo or BMW, whatever it is up there, and won the show. So then BMW got hold of the car, and they documented that car as if they were to build a Beamer station wagon of that era. That's exactly how they would have done it.
Wow.
Yeah, so he's got a big write-up on it.
Wow.
So the only thing that we didn't have time to do was he wanted to make the rear window hatch. So basically, I just took the rear window and moved it all the way to the back of the taillights.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in a crunch, I was like, just put the window back in there. Don't open it. You know. So now he wants it to open. And I wanted to channel it like you would do a safari window.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't find a channel.
Yep.
So he calls me. He says, well, I got Street Metal Concepts to do it. It's like, sweet, that's awesome.
Right. I mean, we kind of have a sort of simple solution. I don't know. It's going to depend on the rigidity of the glass he got.
Yeah.
You know, on how weather tight it'll be, mm-hmm. you know, because basically it's going to be a frameless glass.
That's yes. And that's what I wanted to do.
And it'll be coolest that way.
Yep.
But, you know, it's acrylic. And so, you know, it latch hinges, I mean, you don't really have to alter the car. That's be the most ideal way.
Right.
But when you latch in the middle, are the sides going to flex? Or right. if you latch it and it looks nice, does it really push right. on the seal enough?
Yeah.
And, you know, if it's more of a fair weather car, then that's easier, you know.
I doubt the car will ever see rain. I don't think right. it's ever seen a water hose.
I was like, we can make a piece of glass for it, but that yeah. shape, you know,
it'd be hard.
You have to machine mm-hmm. a billet buck to yeah, form to make the it. Glass on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that was the issue. So basically, what I wanted to do at first, I was like, okay, well, let's find the channel. We'll channel it like you would do a safari windshield on a bus. It's framed,
yeah,
right,
yeah,
rubbered yeah, in, yeah. and then they got this slip-on seal with a loop seal on it. That works perfect for the buses. I was like, that's really the only way we can take the original glass and do that, and what we'll do is we'll put a piano hinge to that, just like a bus, mount it on the inside, close it, done.
Right.
But I could not find nobody to build the channel. I called all these companies to do all the safari windshields, and they're like, no, we have a stamp that does those. We, you know, we can't do such a big window. I'm like, dude, I'll ship the window to you. Just do this for me. I couldn't get no one to do it. And I was just like, you know how much time I would have in building a channel for that window?
$8,000 window frame.
It's, I know.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, so I kind of scratched it, and I was like, I just don't know where to go with it. And he's like, well, I don't either, but, you know, BMW wants the car. They want to do a big spread on it. I'm like, that's fine.
BMW
you
know, can cool. make the channel.
Yeah, they can make it.
Yeah, yeah. You know,
that's pretty cool that you got some accolades from the manufacturer, though.
Yeah, it's a beautiful car. It's black.
I know that. I mean, it's kind of funny when you had Ford reach out to you about the Roadster, and I know none of us need the manufacturers to pat us on the back, no, but it's pretty nice. Cool, though.
Yeah, yeah. It is.
It's kind of cool to have yeah. them go. Yeah, that's pretty dope.
They invited us to bring a car to that 33 to SEMA to be in their booth.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And I just delivered the car to Texas.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, you're going to pay for me to take another 2 weeks off? Because I just took a week off, and that hurts my company.
You ain't kidding.
That, you know, I drove this thing to Texas out of courtesy, you know, to have a nice delivery experience for the owner that had us build Absolutely. This cool hot rod,
mm-hmm.
and that was cool. And now I'm back, and I got to catch up, you know. And so I'm going to take 2 weeks off. I'm going to drive to Texas, drive to Vegas, babysit the car, and then drive back to Texas, drop back off. Hopefully, nothing happened to it while I was right. there, and then go back.
Yeah.
And they're like, "No, you should be honored." I'm like, "I'm honored, you asked."
Yeah,
yeah,
sure.
It is an honor,
and we're done there. The honor is fulfilled.
You know, I got it.
Yeah, that was on a Sunday. I found out that because my buddy took his bus and won, and in the background was the BMW. So I hit Curtis. And I was like, "Dude, were you there?" I said, "If you'd have told me you were there, I would have shown up." He's like, "It was last minute kind of thing." I was like, "Well, that's fine, you know." It's like, "You better throw my name in there." He's like, "Oh, I did."
They all know
that you built it, you know, because I had to make the inner panels too.
All right, right. Yeah.
And I made the jack access, you know, on one side where the jack goes. I made an access plate for
cool.
You know, and I cut the bulkhead out for the back seat.
It was factory-ish.
It was a factory-ish job.
You know, it looked like that's how it would have been.
That's how I am. Yeah, that's why I built my bus the way I built it, because if they would have, and it's funny, people argue about my bus all the time. They're like, dude, that's an original bus, because they look at all the stampings right on my welds. Are, you know, like, mm-hmm. no, I've seen guys lose $20 over it.
Yeah.
And stand back. And, just like, and they look at me and there's your bus. I'm like, yeah. And he's like, and I'm like, no, it's fake.
Yeah.
You know? And I also put a walkthrough section. So they had a bulkhead. Mm-hmm. So now, you know, you could walk in to get in the back seat.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah. So it's a really cool bus. And it was a gift from Gerson. So it's sentimental. Dude, I probably never.
It seems
I've
like,
been offered a lot of money for it, and I've always done it now.
Yeah, that's cool that one was a gift. You were telling me earlier the Lincoln that is kind of your daily driver is a gift too.
My Lincoln was a
man.
Gift.
This seems like you just constantly
I do
get blessed.
I gotta hang out with you more.
Yeah,
I know.
Well, you're gonna you will now.
Yeah, yeah, you're two blocks away.
You can be lunch buddies.
The next car that comes up, I'm like, nah, I don't want it, but Ziploader might want it.
I met the chef at the restaurant.
Dude, he's the new guy.
And he's got like all these plans for like making that a good spot, and like I've ate there a couple times.
I had a special yesterday. It was awesome.
Okay, so what are we talking about?
Over here in Millionaire.
there's over a hangar.
The hangar. Oh, yeah, the hangar.
There's a restaurant in it. Oh, okay. And this guy that's, you know, culinary artist, you know, has got a job there running it.
They got a little cafe in there.
He's wanting to up the what's there.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, sir.
Don't go dry, my friend.
Yeah, I won't.
Don't go dry.
But, yeah, my brother has a flight club out here. So he owns Sanford Orlando Flight Club.
Yeah, we were talking earlier. His connections.
Yeah.
So, yeah, tell Zip about, I don't know if you know about the whole background of the zoo and everything else.
Yeah, my dad and Jack Hanna ran the original Sanford Zoo, and they are the ones that moved it out to where it is now. So
where was it?
It used to be where the city hall is.
No kidding.
That used to be
right? Zoo.
Wow. But,
you know, when that's I was
pretty
a kid,
wild, isn't it?
Yeah. And then they moved it out there, and Jack Hanna, my brother's was heavily involved in the zoo out there.
Yeah.
So, but when we were kids, he had a tiger and I had a lion. You know, for a short time, but we had them. You know, they were cubs and they needed to be around people. So my dad stuck them.
Because that's what you do. You just hang out with a cub.
Yeah, we used to take them to the beach. We'd roll the lion down to the beach. We got pictures of that when I was a kid.
That's cool.
You know, just on a leash, man.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we got definitely ties to Sanford.
Yeah. See?
Yeah, you know, I moved my shop here because there was a shop that had a booth available. You know, I first opened in Longwood, and I hadn't really spent much time at all in Sanford. You know, I'd come to the dirt mall once in a while, and that was about it, you know. And then I moved away and then moved back and opened up in Longwood, and then we outgrew that real quick.
Yeah.
And I needed a bigger shop, and I needed a booth, and it was all there. You know, so we came up here, talked to him, came to agreement, and then drove a little further down.
Yeah. There's that shop.
Beautiful, historic downtown. Like, I had no idea that was there.
Yep. Downtown's fun.
It's awesome.
And the city's dumped a lot of money into it.
They have done very
well
with
it. There's a lot of really great restaurants there. And
there's, I guess, a new craft cocktail bar that opened downtown across from the old Wells Fargo. The owner came in today and he needed this little bracket welded to, and he's like, I just need this welded on there, can you do that? I'm like, yeah, no problem. And welded it, and he's like, all your guys come in, first drinks on the house.
Yeah, they're all, it's the nightlife down there is fun.
It stepped up a lot.
I used to do downtown Orlando back in the day. That's where the kids go. Sanford's for adult nightlife.
It is.
You know.
And it's a good adult life. Now, I see, my parents divorced. My father and I lived on a houseboat down at the marina because my brother had already moved
out. That's cool.
So every time I was in trouble, I was grounded to the lake.
Yeah.
You know, but we had a sailboat down there, and we had windsurfers, and we had a little Boston Whaler we could take out and go skiing in the lake anytime we want. So being grounded was not a bad thing.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I call my best friends up. Hey, man, I'm grounded. I can't come up. Great.
I'll be with you.
We're on our way.
Let's go.
They're like, finally, got grounded, you know. But
you got to step it up.
Sanford was a ghost town.
Yeah.
You know, where Henry's Depot is, dude. I used to ride my BMX bike in that building when I was a kid. Or I'd skate on First Street. Yeah, because it was wide open. You know, it was a packing house when I was a kid. There was nothing on First Street. Antique shops, and that was it. And then it just gradually started growing. My brother's a huge part of that. You know, he was the trolley that was due to my brother. He's really stepped it up down there, and he brings that, you know, and he's a huge part of our Volkswagen show too.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember Thunders in the Street with this with the motorcycles. They did Bike Week here. They did the air shows.
Okay.
That was all my brother. He did all that.
No kidding.
Yeah. So just, I mean, it's your hometown.
Well, you've actually started your own show.
Yes.
When
this will
COVID
be our fourth
hit.
Year.
And you started a show then, and got here in downtown Sanford. When is that show?
That one is going to be January 20th this year, or next year.
Yeah.
Henry's Depot, and it's going to roll into the Unfurl, which is behind there. I don't know if you've ever been to Unfurl.
Yeah, I met the owner.
Yeah, Sean.
Yeah.
Sean's doing the bikes down there now, like the cafe racers. So him and I and my brother, we collided, and he actually, Sean approached me. I drove my bus down there for lunch, and he's like, dude, I love Volkswagens. Want to have a show? I'm like, yeah, I'm in.
Yeah.
He's like, you know, okay, well, I'll tell you what, I'm going to take care of everything. You just get the people here.
Yeah.
I was like, dude, that's a deal. I can do that. And I promoted the crap out of it. We did it in 4 months.
Yeah, the first one, you said you had 250
cars.
buses. VWs. Yeah.
Yep. The first year. The following year was a bomb because it was cold. It was miserable. I think we had a $150 there. That was, you know,
That's still a good show.
Packed. And we really announced it more. We had more walk-in spectators than we did people with the cars.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to change it up a little bit this year, and we're going to do some, you know, other things with it. But it's growing.
Now, is there a website that connects to that show?
Yeah, that one's going to be on henrysdepot.com, daviscustoms.net. We will be posting it on there. We're going to put it everywhere. We're going to put flyers everywhere. Yeah. So.
And for everybody that's kind of listening to the show, Sanford, so, and Florida.
And Volkswagen.
Yeah,
it's air cooled. I mean,
Porsches too, or
air
cooled.
Yeah, my brother has a 72 Targa that we're restoring right now.
Mm-hmm.
He plans on having it there.
Yeah.
So what I do is basically right in front of the fancy road, we call it on the side there. There's a section that's blocked off for me.
Yeah.
That's where all my cars of the year get showed. You know, all my nice cars, nice paints, and all that. So the Porsche is gonna be one of them.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll bring them in.
I don't think I have anything air-cooled.
That's okay.
I can come on foot.
I tell you what, whatever you do drive down there, I would probably put you in a special spot. I'll put you in a special spot.
Yeah. He's cool. Well,
I'll be like, put him in here. You know, I want to put my brother's Mustang in it, but he hasn't agreed to that yet.
Well, for all the listeners that are listening, Sanford is just north of Orlando. So whenever that you're stuck up north, and you need some place to go.
Yeah.
Florida's a great place to be there.
Yeah.
You know, definitely check out that show. Because, I mean, you said the last one had, what, 350 cars?
Yeah, about 320.
That's impressive.
It is. It is. And it's growing. I mean, we just wanted to try it 1 year because we want to get people out on COVID. You know, they were locked up. They just wanted to get the Volkswagens out.
And with the VW community.
It's huge.
Is that all, that 350, mostly local, or is that coming out of state too?
That's south, north. Really? I think, we had Tennessee, we had Alabama, North Carolina.
I'd say Utah even.
Yeah. Utah. Yeah, we gave them a gift for coming the furthest.
Oh, yeah.
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 And they've made it a trip, you know. They're like, well, we're going down Florida anyway. So, you know, I'm like, well, that still counts because you drove that thing all the way. You're brave, man. But, yeah, they wouldn't hit campsites on the way down, you know. Older couple, retired, and just
awesome.
Loving it, man. Cool. Yeah, but the Volkswagen community is amazing. It's a really good community to be in.
Talking about this show, you said it was held at Henry's place. Is that what
Henry's Depot?
Okay, Henry's Depot, which is an old train depot that they've refitted and has multiple restaurants inside of it, coffee shop, a few little bar and everything.
All
in there.
The food in there is great.
Yep.
Yeah,
it's all great.
But your wife, who's an artist, also did some murals there too.
Yeah,
she
did the train. It's down there at the end. It's a big wall. It's got the train.
Mm-hmm.
So. Sean wanted her to do something to bring in because Sanford was a huge train depot.
Yeah.
And Henry Depot was actually, I learned a lot just because she researched everything, you know, and he was actually from like New York and he brought this depot down here to get people here. So he did the packing house.
Yeah.
And all the trains. So the Pico building that's on the other side was his Pico building.
Okay.
So she researched it. Sean says, this is what I want. So she went and did it. And that's actually her first big mural that she's done. She's done several since then. She's done soccer, like a whole wall in this kid's room. It's a soccer field.
Yeah, I've seen her work. She's amazing.
Yeah. It's like, wow. I mean, you know, I wouldn't probably, like, once again, wouldn't be sitting here talking to you guys if it wasn't for my wife, you know, because she's a huge backbone for me. She's like, you got talent. You need to be out there. You need to do it. So she was my social media for the first few years of this. You know, she took care of everything.
Mm-hmm.
And now I just take it and run with it, you know, because we post every day.
Oh, cool.
Every day. If I walk in there and whatever car I'm working on that day gets posted that evening.
Yeah, that's a good.
Yeah. Well, it's good for the customer.
Yeah. No, they can see what's
going on. They know, and they know to get ready to get billed.
Yep.
So, if I'm working on it, I'm billing you.
Yeah.
So, which works out perfect, but she's been such a huge success. So, you know, now it's her turn.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've already established what I need to do here. Now we're getting her out there, and she's really getting really big with it. You know,
she always been an artist?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Does she do any shows or anything like that where she displays her art?
She really doesn't.
Yeah.
She does it online now. It's word of mouth. Yep.
Yeah.
She doesn't know.
And what is like her media that she prefers to do?
Trees.
Yeah.
She does a lot of trees. Yeah. She'll do anything. She just did a guy fishing with a dog. I don't know if you saw that when mm-hmm. I posted it. That was five different pictures
yeah.
that this lady gave her and says, well, I want the dog on the boat with him fishing. You know, it's yep. all flashed together. Yeah. And she does it. It's just amazing. I just love to sit there and watch her do it. You know, she's yeah. got a studio at the house.
Yeah.
I've been trying to get the other office at the house, at the shop, but she, no. I don't want to be with you all day. Yeah. You know, it's loud.
Yeah.
It's loud at the shop. So, yeah. But yeah, she does
you
awesome.
You won't find her zen. She's not yeah. going to find her
yeah.
her center there.
Yeah. And it's nice to have that space during the day.
Yeah.
And it's nice to go home. But yeah, she's yeah. an amazing woman. She was Air Force. She mm-hmm. fought in, she was service over in Iraq,
yeah.
you know, for 3 years. She did really good. She's just an awesome person.
That's cool.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. Now, does she have any way people can see her
yes.
work and everything?
Yes. She is HollyDavisArt.
Okay.
.com. Or it's, there's another one, but it's HollyDavisArt.
Facebook.
Yep. She's on Instagram. Facebook, Instagram.
Okay.
Yep. She's
that's
on
the same thing, HollyDavisArt.
Yep.
Okay.
Cool. Yeah.
So. Very cool. And you also have three daughters.
Yeah. My oldest is Savannah.
Mm-hmm.
My middle one is Nova. And yeah. then my youngest one is Shelby.
Yeah.
Yeah. Car people.
All car names. Yeah. Whether they like it or not.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know what? We yeah. sat down and talked about it. And you can't do Mercedes because that's too much like a.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Don't want that one. And Porsche is right there with it.
Yeah.
So, but I talked about Ron Smith, you know, the guy I did the machine shop with. He had his daughter was named Shelby, and I just yep. always loved that name.
Yep.
I was like, my brother's a Shelby guy.
Yeah.
He's a Ford guy. And I was like, well, kill two birds with one stone. I like the name and
yeah.
make my brother feel good, you know.
Yeah.
Nova was entirely named because I'm a Nova guy.
Yeah.
And the stars, that's yeah. what they claim. But
no, my first marriage.
It's Nova.
It's Nova.
Scratch.
In my first
Scratch wasn't Scratch. A good daughter's name.
Yeah, it wasn't either, man. And that's what I told her. I said, well, Nova's not too bad because I don't ever call my car Nova. It's Scratch, you know. I'm like, yeah I'm good with that. Let's
yeah.
do it. Let's do it.
No, in my first marriage, we got a puppy. And she's like, whatever you do, don't name it any stupid car names. That was the directive I got.
Mm-hmm.
So the dog's name was Shelby. It wasn't until like 3 months later, I was like, hey, look at that. That's a Shelby. And she looked at me and was like, you son of a bitch.
Yeah. Gotcha. Well, now my daughter, Shelby, when she's riding down the road and she sees a Shelby, she yep. freaks out.
And she's like, hey.
Oh, my God, there. That's Nova's the same me. Way. She's like, yeah. that car said Nova.
Yeah.
I'm like, you're a Nova.
That's cool.
I'm a car. Yes, you're a car.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
It's in your blood. So I hope to have them welding and painting by next year.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's my goal.
Exactly. Yeah. They just carry on the yeah. family business.
Yeah, actually, Nova came. Sometimes Nova will come with me. Shelby will stay home.
Yeah.
So Nova came in a couple weeks. Friday is work on scratch day. Except for today, I went and picked up some raggedy old Mercedes that uh-huh. was rotted completely out. But it was cool to go. It had a rag top in it.
Hey.
This thing wow. was cool, man. It was just cool. To do it. It was awesome yeah, to go yeah. check it out. But she, a couple weeks ago, we put the motor in scratch. So she got to run the cherry picker. She never jacked
yeah,
the motor.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I was like, you're getting ready to pick up like almost 1,000 pounds, you know.
Yep.
She's like, oh my gosh.
Yep.
You know, cool, man. So they're getting into it.
I know.
You know?
Cool.
Shelby's going to be my motorhead.
Yeah.
She reminds me of myself when I was a kid. She's playing with Hot Wheels, you know, and that's where it started.
Yep.
You know, it started with Hot Wheels. And then I went into models. And I did model shows in Florida. Mm-hmm. And the model that's in my office right now was the model I did in 1985 and took second place for the entire state.
Wow.
Yeah.
No kidding.
It's all brass tube chassis. So I learned to solder at a young age.
That's cool.
Yeah, I burn a lot of fingers.
Yeah.
but it's
That's
really cool
learn.
Car. It's, you know, it's tube chassis.
Yeah.
I've always been infatuated with, like, tube chassis cars. It's just, they're cool that you can cut a car up and build a new chassis and drive
yeah.
it on the street. It's just awesome, you know.
Yep.
And it's like the exhaust. I built the headers. The headers are all handmade, and I used the white electrical wire
yeah.
out of a harness. Yep. So I was telling him the other day that all the gauges are out of hot rod magazines. So I would
yeah.
flip through magazine after magazine,
and, paste those
and I would cut the little lenses out and put them inside the dash.
Nice.
So you could go into magnifying glass and see all autometer gauges.
That's
and all
cool.
the MSD boxes I made, the everything.
Yep.
If it's computerized in the car, it's labeled from a hot rod magazine.
That's funny.
So,
yeah, I think we were talking about in the earlier episode, I think in episode 2, Like, I was into modeling when I was a kid, you know, and I would, you know, shave and chop different cars. And, you know, it would take four models to make one, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it was years later, my X-Acto blade box, there was like a kit that had all these different blades in it.
Yeah.
I found it, and I was like, oh, that's kind of cool. And then I opened it up. I'm like, good God, how many times did I cut myself? Every blade's covered in blood.
I would shave the bodies and always take the thumb out.
I'd take the top of your thumb,
So I learned a guy that was building models at the time, he says, get you some duct tape, put it on your fingers.
Yep.
And it'll slow the blade down.
Yeah.
Because they were
sharp. At least it'll give you a little bit of head.
Yeah. I used to have to heat the blade up to cut the doors out.
To cut through the plastic.
Yeah. To cut through there. Yeah, and then I learned that they had Dremel tools that did that.
Woohoo! Yeah, right.
That was the greatest thing. Because that 57 model is a 1/12 scale. So it came complete with the trunk and the doors and the front end where I cut everything apart.
Yeah.
So the doors open, the trunk opens, everything on the car is exposed. And it has all aluminum interior and everything that I made. I even built the rear wheels because you couldn't get the scale.
Yeah.
The rear tires are RC car. So
I went to I forget what store I was at, but they had models there, and I was like, you know, my son's 7. I'm like, maybe if I could find one that's kind of we could put. All of a sudden, I'm like, when the hell did models become $35?
Yeah,
like never mind.
$6.99.
They were $6.99.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yep.
Hot Wheels were 88 cents.
Yep.
You know, I would get $50 for my birthday, and my mom would take Kmart, and I'd spend $50 on Hot Wheels.
Yeah.
I probably had 3,000 Hot Wheels.
Oh my God.
When I was a kid.
Yep.
And all my dresser in my bedroom at the top three drawers, they started taking over the Hot Wheels.
That's funny.
And it was packed. It was stuffed. I had my dad ended up disposing of them when I lived in Washington.
Yeah.
So now every time that Hot Wheel comes up that's worth a lot of money,
I'll
text it to him and say, look at there, I had three of those. But just reminding you, he still tells me
you
all the time.
Me.
He's still like, you're just never gonna let me do it. I was like, nope, I'm not gonna let you live it down.
Ever.
Because that was like, you know,
right
as soon as I came back from Washington, you know, I was 18 years old or so, and I walked in, got in the boat, and I was like, where's my Hot Wheels? Oh, son, they're gone.
No, they ain't.
What? Repeat yourself again?
This ain't going to work.
I got to go.
I'm moving. I'll be out of here in the next couple of days. But, I won't let him live it down.
So you say you post daily, and that's on Instagram, Facebook. Okay, so both of them. Yeah. So what is your Instagram and Facebook?
Davis Customs.
Just Davis Customs.
Okay. It'll have a logo. It doesn't necessarily show this logo. It's like a crown. Mm-hmm. It's got a reddish crown, but it's Davis Customs. I think my Facebook one is this logo.
Yeah.
My wife had me sit down and do this logo.
Yeah.
In about 2 seconds.
I like it.
It was like
it works.
God damn it! There you go. And she's like, my God, that's good. Because she's been bugging me for 2 months. She's like, you have to do a logo because I need to send it in so we can do this. And she set a paper down. She actually put a beer there. Here's your beer. Here's your paper.
Your incentive.
Do not get up here until you finish this. I was like, all right, well, cool. And I was like, how about that? She's like, that's perfect.
So, nice. And then she it looks good with the
V.
The van.
Yeah. Yep. It's a bus.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Bus. Van.
Sorry.
Oh, my bad.
Yeah,
We're taking them out.
I know.
But you're done.
Everybody does it. I got to correct my mom every once in a while. Oh, that's a nice van. Not a van, Mom.
Yeah.
It's a bus.
That's like in the Jeep world. People go, hey, that's a nice truck. It's a Jeep, man. It's not a truck.
Yeah. And if you bondo it up good enough, it's a Jeep.
Yeah, well, there's that. I've seen a couple of those.
Yep. I've done a couple of Jeeps.
Well, Jason, thank you so much, man.
Yeah, man.
That's awesome hearing your story.
Awesome. Yeah.
Yep, and I can't wait till obviously neighbors.
I know, man. This is awesome.
Yeah. You'll be good.
So this won't be the last time.
No, we'll
hang out some more.
Yeah, it'd be good times.
Well, the one thing I wanted to kind of also share, just kind of out of fun, was car movies that spoke to us when we were growing up. I know for myself, like top car movie would have been for me was Smokey and the Bandit.
Like, I think that's everybody.
Like, I think that one was all-time classic. The black and gold Trans Am was awesome. I wanted to be a truck driver when I was a kid
because
of that movie,
because
man.
Of that movie.
You know,
I saw that movie at the 99-cent theater. Probably 10 times a day.
I know.
You know, we saw it. We knew it word to word.
And, you know, I think it was probably, well, the girls were still in the house. I got that movie, found it on Netflix or something, and I made the girls watch it, right? I was like, all right, y'all are watching this tonight. It holds up, man. Yeah, man. It still holds up. Yeah. Like, the comedy's great. The flows really well. Because there's a lot of times you watch an old movie, and then you're just kind of like, man, this thing's really dragging on, you know? But that one, it flows good.
It does.
It's a lot of fun. Yeah. You know, they all like that. That was a great movie, mm-hmm. you know? But that's definitely probably my top car movie. I would say number two for car movies would be Days of Confused.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
like, dude, Wooderson rolling in the Chevelle.
It reminded me of a night in my hometown, honestly.
Dude, that was Crescent City growing up, where I grew up, you know?
Yeah. What was that?
Party at the Moon Tower,
but
dude.
But it was mini trucks instead of muscle cars.
Ours was still muscle cars, man. Yeah. There was a dude in our high school that had a 70 Camaro, a Fox Body Mustang, of course. Another dude had a 72 Monte Carlo. I had my old truck. You know, there was old cars in our parking lot. And, like, that whole movie, watching it, was just a total rollback to, like, what it was growing up in school.
I would have to say, I mean, I have a bunch. Like,
yeah.
American Graffiti with the cars, classic. Blacktop.
Yep.
That was a good one. I love Back to the Future.
Okay.
Because of the cars in the background.
Yep.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I'd be like, oh, my God, it's 47, you know.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't care about the DeLorean. I've seen 100 million.
Toyota truck and Marty's
Toyota.
Yeah,
the truck, that made them, that made Toyota infamous.
Yeah, the truck was cool, you know. So I renamed that Fast and Furious. I don't associate with them movies at all, but I call them the Slow and the Frustrated.
Yeah.
Yeah, so no cars there at all.
I saw a meme the other day where it showed like a bolt shift pattern, you know, and it was like the first one was like a standard 6-speed. The next one said Fast and the Furious, and there was like 30 numbers.
Yeah.
And then the last one, shifting. You would love it because it said Volkswagen.
Oh,
and it was
everywhere.
Just a squiggle line all over the place. And I was like, that's so perfect.
There is absolute 100% truth to that.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. You just go, man, until you find
third
it.
Third right. There it is.
Yeah.
Oh, nope.
Done it a million times. Yeah, absolutely, man. That's how them Volkswagens are.
Yeah.
You got to spend $1,000 to get a good shifter to make them shift right.
Yeah, that's
the
funny.
Wraith was my, like, all-time favorite. Like
Wraith?
What is that?
It's called The Wraith.
I don't know anything about it.
Look it up.
I'm gonna.
It was an 80s movie. I remember I was at this girl that lived up the street. I was probably 11 or 12, you know. I was in love with her. And, you know, we'd hang out. And her older brother, who had a Mustang Cobra 2, you know, or maybe it was her sister's boyfriend, I forgot. But anyway, we were hanging out and we watched this movie, The Wraith, and it was like this, I think it was like a converted Firebird or something.
Okay.
I'm not sure, but it was like a one-off body on it. And I was just like...
Yeah, that's a slope front end.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it was killing people.
Right.
Yeah, I know that movie.
Right.
I don't know.
Yeah. It's kind of a horror movie.
Kind of in the
movie.
Desert kind of thing.
Right. Yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
And you know, like they would race people, and then all of a sudden it would zip off, and then the car racing would come around the corner, and he's coming back at him or in the way. And then
it's kind of like Knight Rider car.
Well, right. So this was after Mad Max, then.
Oh, this was probably before Mad Max.
Might have been.
Well, Mad Max was like 79, 80.
Yeah, this
the
was,
first
the,
one.
This okay. was early to mid 80s. Probably
yeah,
mid 80s.
So
it was a
been
cheesy
after.
Movie.
Yeah, it was like I haven't gone back and watched it. I probably won't.
Yeah,
it'll probably
because it'll
ruin
it. You.
Like, I like this. This was
but
horrible.
I do know the car. It's like a cross between Knight Rider and something else. It's a black.
Yeah,
yeah.
I think it's
spaceship
like gray
looking car.
And you know, it's right, way futuristic for the time.
Yeah.
You know, and look it up. You'll probably call me and be like, dude, that movie, why'd you make me watch that? But for me, it stuck out in my head forever.
Yeah.
It's like to this day, like, man, that was, it, I don't know, it was like, whoa.
Yeah.
At the end, it was the car.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't care about the story.
I like Cooper.
Yeah. Cooper, what's that movie?
Cooper came out with, that was Burt Reynolds and the other guy that had the jet on the back of the red Firebird.
I don't know if I've seen this one.
Yeah, that one, it came out about the same time right after Smokey and the Bandit did.
Really?
Yeah. And they were stunt drivers. and they drove this car across country that was a jet powered Firebird, like a 77.
Really?
Firebird. Yeah. It was red. And they jumped bridges and they did all kinds of monkey stuff. I don't, the movie, it was kind of like that movie. It just didn't take off. Well, you know, it was a spinoff.
Smokey and the Bandit, that story was written by, what was his, he was a stunt man for Burt Reynolds. I can't think of his name right now. But he wrote Smokey and the Bandit and directed that. Yep. And then he did all the, what was the ones where they did the Cannonball?
Yeah, Cannonball Run. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, that same
That's about the same era.
Yep.
I think it was called Cooper.
Really?
Yeah. Huh. I got a Smokey and the Bandit car at the shop now.
Oh, do you?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's a 7. It is the Smokey. It's got the small T-tops.
Cool.
Yeah, so I'm doing...
Oh, there's two different T-top sizes? Yes. I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. 76, the T-top went bigger.
Yep.
I learned that, too, because I didn't know that.
Yeah.
77 was the Smokey and the Bandit car.
Right. Oh.
So the T-top, where the corner window met the door glass, it came in, there was a lip, and then it went up.
Yep.
And same with the windshield.
Yeah, that first gen almost looks like
it was very small.
Cut.
Yeah.
Into it, where the second gen
was like it was a targa with a bar.
Yeah.
Right.
So that's, and in between the windows were a lot fatter than they were. But yes, I did it for 1 year, and that was a 77 Smoking Bandit car. And this is a Smoking Bandit car.
Yeah.
The only thing this thing's missing is a 4-speed.
Yep.
It's an automatic car, but it's got everything else. So we're going to take it back to the original. That car, he bought that car in 1980, I want to say 3 or 4.
Wow.
It's been sitting, and it's young blood out there at the Port of Sanford. He moves houses and buildings.
Okay.
Huge company. He's been there for a million years. It's Mr. Youngblood's son owns the car, and he's owned it since then. So
that's cool.
He wants to put it back to like the Smoking Bandit car.
Right. Nice.
But it's a really nice car. There's rust, but it's not in where you think it would be.
Right.
Yeah.
You know? We did it was 81, actually.
I like 81.
And, it was still that generation, but it had the
four square two headlights.
Separate
square. Yeah, it's got the square headlights.
Instead
of
the, cutout.
That's when they changed. But, it was 80.
And this was an all-original car. The vinyl stickers were perfect.
Oh, wow.
I mean, this thing was in good shape.
Yeah.
And we put an LS3 and T56.
I remember that car.
And brakes and all that. Yep. And then... He was dying to paint the car, and I'm like, no.
Leave it alone, dude.
Don't touch it, man.
And then he ended up having it painted.
Really?
Not by us, and but whatever.
Yeah. No, not my car.
Yeah, it's wild when you look at, like, every year for the Firebird, that bird changed.
Yeah.
Shuttle change in
well,
it,
they,
you know.
Smoking
I want it's
the
like
Bandit,
every 2 years.
The reason they came out with that movie at that time is they were trying to promote that car, and they did. They promoted it well because that car sold like hotcakes after that.
Yeah, and the color combination was based off of a Formula One car.
Yes, the black and gold.
Yep, the Players Club.
Yep. I like all the gold striping. This one had all the gold striping and everything. We're going to put it back on there.
Yeah, it looks so
good. We're going to put the bird back on there.
Yep.
They had a quick paint job at Mako in the 80s or something.
Yeah.
Right.
Whatever.
Yeah.
But we're birding it, so
that's
we're
cool.
going to put it back. And I want to clear the bird into the car.
Yeah.
So I want all that. Yeah, that'd be cool.
Anybody going to go see the, GT, Gran Turismo coming up?
I didn't hear
about it. It's a new movie out.
Yeah, so that's based on a true story where they had video gamers riding real race cars.
Yeah.
So they did this whole school and everything else. And the movie looks kind of cool.
It makes sense. I mean, if you sit there and play a video game all day, surely you can go out there.
Yeah.
What about all these kids in there playing war? Now, if something breaks out, they're going to be the ones who won. They're the Patriots. They're going to come out and
get off your diet of Doritos and Mountain Dew, though.
We can
need you to be a little more fit.
These kids are like, dude, I've been playing this game for years. Now we get to do it for real.
But they'll do it with robotics. It'll all be a soldier of robots.
Well, that was us with the Atari.
Terminator is coming up soon.
Yeah, absolutely. Man.
Yeah.
That's great.
Oh, man. Well, cool, man. Jason, again, thank you so much.
Absolutely, man. I appreciate the invite.
Yep. This and, we'll do it again soon.
Absolutely. Just let me know. I'll be here.
Yep. And for everybody that's watching the show, definitely come out and support us at factoryish.com. We got apparel there. And you can also listen to us on Spotify, iTunes, iHeartRadio, Google Podcast, and I'm always
missing. Don't you just say, and wherever you listen to your podcast.
It's at all of them. We got it covered. Yeah. And of course, YouTube. Duh. That's the best one to watch us at.
Then you can watch it. I do not listen to podcasts.
I don't either.
I watch
it. I watch it on YouTube.
And I barely have time for that.
I watch y'all.
I barely have time to even watch or listen.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, that one time, you know, like oil and whiskey, I'll catch once in a while and usually fall asleep and while watching it. And, you know.
Yep. I know.
I'll talk cars.
But listen to ours.
I'll talk cars all night.
But listen to ours and watch it on YouTube.
Yeah, man.
Awesome. Well, again, thanks again, Jason. Yes, I appreciate it.
All right, man.
All right. Thanks. Take care. See ya.
Don't forget about me.